Hi. I captured some footage recently for some upgrades that I did to my pump it up machine. I put up a video a while ago of getting into my house in the first play. One of the things I wanted to do was to put LEDs in the pads, because the CCFL tubes that were in there were very weak. I didn't really like them very much. From another guide, from somebody who did this to a DDR machine, I got a link to these specific LEDs. I'll put it in the description. These are little modules with four or five LEDs in them. They're very, very bright. And they basically can work as drop-in replacements for the tubes. Now, it takes a little bit of doing to make that happen. I have to do some soldering and wiring here. So those two wires connect to there's a plug in each panel that plugs into the CCFL system in there now. I found the appropriate size of header, which I need to solder onto the wire in order to make it a connector for to just drop in and replace. You could just connect the wires directly, just cut off the connector that's in the pad, but I didn't want to do that. I wanted these to be removable so I could put back in the originals if I really wanted to. So I'm going to do some soldering here. This is a technique that I found when Googling for how to solder to pin headers. That's actually a kneadable eraser there. It was the only thing of that sort that I had. So basically, you stick the long prongs of those into something soft like clay or a kneaded eraser, and attach a little bit of solder to each end you'll be soldering to. So I'm heating up the pin, attaching the solder to it, then you cut it with the iron eventually, and it leaves just a little bit of solder on there. So this made it pretty easy to solder to these things. They're pretty small. I've always found soldering a very frustrating, annoying process, but I looked up enough guides, tried to figure out what the heck I needed, got all the appropriate tools, and I'm finally having kind of an okay time with it. It's still really fiddly and frustrating at times. My iron doesn't heat evenly. Sometimes I'll touch it to something and just nothing happens. Anyway, I have a sponge just off screen where I'm wiping off the excess solder and stuff. That was one recommendation that I had never done before that I tried, and it seemed to work. So both of those pins have a little bit of blob of solder on them. I can take the wires that I want to attach to them. The idea is I touch the wire to the pin, I touch the soldering iron to the pin, and the extra solder around it just flows around the two and connects them. That one worked perfectly. The second one is a little bit harder to navigate into place. The kneaded eraser comes in handy, or blob of clay or whatever you have. Comes in handy for holding it a little bit, but mostly I just use my fingers, get it to the appropriate place. So yeah. Those two are connected now. Those black things that I slipped onto the wires before I started this process are heat shrink tubes. So I want to slide them down and cover those connections just to protect them a little bit. I think those would be fairly brittle if I were to try to bend the pins either way. It'd probably break, so I just try not to do that. So heat shrink tubes take heat and shrink, as the name implies. So you can see them shrinking and shaping around that. And that's a connection. So then just repeat that process nine more times. I had already done a few. That was the one that went best, so that was the footage I show. Alright, so the machine is on in IO test mode. I'm showing just what it looked like with the tube, how dim it was. So, you know, it lights up, but it doesn't do the best job. That little connector that I just disconnected, you'll get a better look at it later, is what connects to those headers. So I used calipers to measure the pitch distance between the two pins and just found on digikey.com, which is a wonderful site for buying these sort of things, found headers with the appropriate pitch that looked like they would work, ordered the right number, and they did. So yeah, you can see just how bright those things are. I'm trying to just kind of set it in there to sort of simulate what it'll look when it's all together. So yeah, that's vaguely what the panel will look like when it lights up with those things. But there's a bunch of stuff I have to do first. So CCFL tube, connector comes out, and the tube itself, I can just sort of set it aside, get rid of it, sell it, whatever, I don't know. I still have them, I don't know what I'll do with them exactly. While I had this here, I took the opportunity to test all of the LEDs that I had soldered, just to make sure they all worked, and they all did. I picked kind of a strange orientation for the headers. It might have worked better the other way. It feels like I'm plugging them in kind of upside down, but that doesn't really matter. Yeah, you can see that's upside down in my head, but I can flex the wires around however I need to. Anyway, so yeah, tested all those, make sure they all work. So then this bit of circuitry that controls the fluorescent tube can just come out of there. It's no longer needed. So I get rid of that. There's a high voltage warning on those. It's actually peeled off of this one. I assume one of the capacitors is something I don't want to touch the wrong way. I managed not to. So I don't need that thing anymore. Those fluorescent tube holders, I was going to take those out. So I take out this screw. But unfortunately, I discover that the thing is actually kind of stuck in place. It's some sort of adhesive. And what I decide to do is just leave it there. Leave it alone. Don't mess with it. So I put the screw back in, and just don't worry about those. I can easily, I have plenty of room to work around them. It might have made sense to take that entire board that these are connected to out of there and just stick the LED on the bare metal below. I didn't do that. I opted to use the board, because yeah, that's just a piece of wood with a couple of wood screws in it holding the stuff in place. It's very, very dirty. The LEDs have some adhesive on the bottom of them, which I'd like to actually be able to stick to it, so wet paper towel cleans those off. I should have done this a lot earlier, but it wasn't really convenient when all the CCFL stuff was in there. So yeah, wipe that down, give it a nice satisfying white sheen. And it looks a whole lot better. This is the player one up left arrow. So all the stuff I'm doing here, just imagine doing it 9 more times for the rest of the arrows. This was a fairly lengthy process, but was actually quite enjoyable to do. So now that that's reasonably clean, this can plug in. On the back of these is a little adhesive strip. It's like two-sided tape with one side covered with some sort of cover. Once I figure out how I want the wire to sit, I can pick a place to stick it. Yep, that should do okay. Each of these was unique. The wires kind of curled around a different way, so I just had to find an orientation that seemed to make sense and wouldn't have wires curling all over the place. Stuff like that. So peel off the thing, stick it on there. And that's mounted. Still lights up, very, very bright. So if I put the panel back on, you can see what it looks like. Very bright. Pretty nice. So I move the camera around here so you can see a comparison between that and the old one. It's a pretty dramatic difference. So the upright panel over there, on the left side of the screen, still has the tube in it. You can just barely see it lighting up. It's kind of amazing. Like, cleaning those things off did help the brightness a little bit, but the LEDs helped much more. So I like the super bright ones. They are very nice. So, another day. Got the LED upgrades in. You'll see more of those later. A much more major thing that I wanted to do was to get a different software version running on the machine. This box had just arrived for me. Found the right people online. It was kinda hard to do. This was a weird process to actually purchase this thing. But eventually I found somebody who would take my money and send me an upgrade to Pump It Up Infinity. So that comes with 3 things. There's a banner. You'll see me mounting that in a moment. It's very simple to do. Looks real nice. I have the marquee beside me. I've already taken it off the machine. And in here is box with hard drive and security dongle. So there's a little USB stick thing that needs to be plugged in for each version of the game so that it'll actually run. Authenticate that it's the real thing. So security there, hard drive wrapped in bubble wrap. So first I'll install the banner. Got the marquee already kind of taken apart. Three screws hold that bottom metal piece in there. I've already taken the screws out of the side ones. So those are the things that hold the banner in place. There are two pieces of plexiglass that it's sandwiched between, so it keeps the thing nice and clean and protected. On the inside of that is a light bulb and a little bit of wiring and nothing else of interest, really. I had just had it open to clean it out since it was a good time to do it. So yeah, just take out the NX Absolute banner, put the Infinity in there, sandwich it between the things, and put everything back. The banner makes a surprising amount of difference in the overall appearance of the machine. So I wanted to be sure to bother to install it and stuff. Screws go back in. Normal stuff. Make sure it's all aligned properly. And there we go. Put the rest of the screws in, and that's done. So mounting this thing back in the machine is kind of a process. It's surprisingly heavy, and there's no real good angle to do it from. So I'm on a step stool in front of the machine. Problem is I have to kind of lean forward holding this heavy thing, and it's really awkward to get it into position. There are also wires, connectors, you can see in my left hand. I need to thread them through one of the holes there. There's a metal bracket that needs to attach to just right. So just kind of finagle everything into place, and eventually it goes where it needs to go. There we go. Seems a little wobbly, but that's seated properly. So in the back of this thing there are some screw holes there. I actually just ran it like this for the first while that I had the machine. I didn't bother putting in the screws. It was fine. It didn't fall over or anything. Sits reasonably firmly, but I decided to put the screws in for this just to be a little bit more proper. So I need to align the screw holes there, make sure I can put them in. And yeah, those three screws. Hold it in place and make sure it doesn't fall off. You can see this speaker on the left there is just a little bit beat up, well, on the right on the screen. Someday I'll have to do something about that, somehow. I don't know what. The outside of this machine has various blemishes on it. Keep finding new things to clean and replace and fix up. It's kind of fun to tinker around with this thing. Just every day I find a little bit of something to do with it. That was making some noises when I was tightening this one. It was like sort of creaking into place. I don't think I had it seated quite all the way, but those are in tight enough. So on the inside, this hole goes up to where the marquee is. I had to fish out those three connectors that were in there, because up top there are speakers and the four lights on the very top, and then the light in the back that lights up the banner. So each of those things has its own connector, I guess. I'm not sure which connector goes where exactly. I just know connector one's the same shape to the inside of the machine. I of course did this whole process in reverse before what you saw, but I figured I'd just capture the putting it back together. So those are all connected. Now, time to install the hard drive and USB dongle thing. So the computer inside this thing is, you know, just pretty much a standard PC. There's nothing all that special about it. Has hard drive and dongle there in the, reasonably accessible in the back. There are two screws holding its enclosure in place. I was lucky enough to get an MK9 machine with what I bought. NX Absolute was the first version that actually came with those. It's the latest spec of computer that goes in pump it up machines. If I had had an MK6 or something earlier, I might have had to buy a full upgrade kit that actually would come with a new computer. That would have been more expensive and more of a pain to install. But since I had the capable one, I could just get the hard drive and everything's good. So I figure out how to get that out of there. Enclosure has hard drive and USB thing. So security dongle comes out. That one's for NX Absolute. And the Infinity one can replace it. And then changing out the hard drive is basically just like changing any other computer hard drive. Just take out the screws if it's secured, take out the connectors, put in the new hard drive, connect it, and you're done. Simple stuff. So you can see I have a USB drive connected. They're sort of in the bottom center of the screen. That's where I have to plug in the USB drive to get the machine to recognize it, because for some reason the USB ports on the front just do not work. I've checked them as well as I can. I can't figure out why they're non-functional. Maybe it's just a faulty circuit board there or something, but if I plug it into the computer directly, it works that way, which is workable for me. Since I'm usually the only one playing on this machine, I can just leave the drive in there. It's not like I have it in a public arcade where a whole bunch of people are coming and going and need to plug in their own drives to track scores and stuff. I would like to fix that at some point, figure out what's wrong with the thing, maybe get a replacement USB box. And the annoying thing about it is it has a connector that solders onto the JAMA interface. You can't actually see it in this shot, but... yeah, soldering is involved. And then two USB extension cords connect to it. I assume that's because you don't want the USB ports on the front to be able to plug in like a keyboard or other stuff that could do mischief with the machine. Like, I could just run two USB extension cords to the front and that would work just fine, I guess, since I don't care about security for my own machine. Anyway, Infinity hard drive is in, screws go back in. I put that screw in a different place by accident, but it really doesn't matter at all. Enclosure can sit back where it was, somehow. That's pretty much it. Put in the last two screws just for completeness. And there we go. That is upgraded to Infinity. So I've been wanting this upgrade since I first got the machine. It's the version that I most desired. It's kind of much more similar to In the Groove than other Pump It Up versions. The entire Pro series is. Infinity is sort of like Pump It Up Pro 3 in a way. So, this is the first startup. I'm hoping it all works. You can still hear that my fan does that same thing. I should replace that fan. It works fine, it's just noisy for a little while when it starts up. But you can't really hear it over the music and stuff. So yeah, Infinity is super cool. It has all sorts of features that I wanted, much more of the kind of music that I like to listen to. So I was super happy to get this. I played for like an hour and a half today, which is longer than I normally play, and got super exhausted, but I was just having so much fun I did not want to stop. So, got a loading screen. That's a good sign. It took a fairly long time to load. I'm leaving in the full time unedited here. I got a little bit antsy as it was doing it. Some people suggest upgrading the RAM in the MK9 when you install Infinity. I had 512 megabytes, which I think is the recommended minimum. It works. I don't know if more would speed up any of these things. Just putting more RAM in a computer does not necessarily make it perform better, if memory is not the bottleneck. So I'm fidgeting around a little bit. You can see my reflection. It's like, is it gonna load? I hope it loads. Got the banner up there looking real good. I end up peeling off that NX Absolute button code sticker on the front because it's for the wrong version and I don't like looking at it anymore. It's already partially peeled off, kind of beat up. So I decide to go over there to do something, and finally, loading screen completes. And there we go. That's actually the sound of a USB drive being mounted, I learned later. So yeah, Infinity is here. So this hard drive shipped to me with the latest version on it. Wait a second, 1.10, I thought it was 1.10. Well, Final Evolution, that's correct. I was prepared to apply patches if it was an older version, but it was the latest. Unlockable songs, still figuring out how the unlock system works. Audio resync, which is nice. It wants to run on a widescreen monitor. You can kind of tell that this is being squished for the 4.3 CRT that I have in here. But the GX cabinet does not come with one of those. It works fine. Just a couple of things in the UI look a little bit squished at times. But I mean, gameplay and everything looks normal. And that's the startup sequence. So right after I installed this, I did a stream on Twitch. I have a couple of songs that I played there, just so you can see what the gameplay with this looks like. So a bunch of differences you'll notice right away from NXA. The arrows are a different color. I have rhythm note skin on, which means that they're colored by, instead of vertical position, they're colored by what kind of note they are. Just like in the groove. That's the way that I like it. There's superb timing, which is a tighter timing window than perfect. Because the perfect window is, like, enormous. Superb is better if I care about timing properly. And I have the distant perspective on. I like to play on distant, just sort of tilts the arrows kind of into the screen at the top a little bit. It's just more comfortable for me to read for some reason. So this has pretty much all the in-the-groove features that I like. Also has percentage scoring. You can see at the top, it instead of just counting up from zero, it seems to predict the percentage score you'll get at the end. So its prediction is I'm gonna get 97.23%. And that goes down if I get misses or whatever. Goes up if I keep getting superbs. Oh, also, you can see the LEDs in action in the pads. So the panels are lighting up much brighter than they were before. I do still have a problem with the Player 2 pad. The I.O. board in it, unfortunately, does not work to light up three of the panels. I have yet to figure out what's wrong with it exactly. I'm trying to get a replacement, But they're turning out to be extremely hard to find, so I might just have to fix the thing myself somehow. I mean, I have two. One of them works properly, one of them does not. They're circuit boards, so just have to figure out, like, which component has gone bad on the bad one and replace it. That's not something I've done very much, and I don't want to accidentally break it, but, like, I mean, I can unsolder stuff and put new ones on if I need to. Sorry for talking throughout that whole song, but I had things to say. So yeah, you can see that only the up left and up right arrows on the player 2 pad light up. Everything's supposed to be lit there. So yeah, still little things to change. Alright, so play again. I'll show you what the menuing and stuff looks like a little bit here.
Alright, let's do some level stuff.
Arcade mode, there's also mission mode, which is interesting. I need to play with it more. Has unique challenges in it. And yes, I play the same song twice in a row, because I wanted to try a different chart. I like this song. It's a good song. I can set my scroll speed much more precisely than before. I can go by quarters of a multiplier, so I can get pretty much exactly what I want to scroll at. So, double mode. It was weird. I got the sense that the pads were behaving better than before. Like, obviously nothing changed with them when I upgraded the software, but it just had a better feel in some intangible way. So yeah, I'm really happy with this upgrade. It's exactly what I ever wanted. Everything I ever wanted with Pump It Up and more. It would be nice to also have Prime available if I wanted to play that, because it has a very different song selection and works differently. But it's not a priority for me to get it. I'm much more interested in Infinity, at least for now. Still plenty of songs there for me to learn. I haven't been through much of the catalog at all. There's a lot to do. The life bar in this version seemed a whole lot more forgiving than NXA was. I didn't change it from the default setting, so maybe it just defaults to something that's not quite as brutal, which is fine with me. If I fail a song, if the life bar goes to zero, I actually get an F at the end, which is a difference. I can't just sort of ignore the life bar, take a break in the middle of the song if I want to, and still get an A. And there's the percent score, so I have a much better, more precise way to measure my performance on a song.
So a problem I'm having...
86.
...is that since I played NXA for a while with the normal arrow colors, I'm used to blue meaning down and red meaning up. So now this rhythm note's going to throw me off. But in this section, like, even more than before.
So what I'm mumbling about there is that the arrow colors are different and I have to get used to it. The color coding actually helped me a little bit in the middle area with double mode. So just have to play more and get used to it. Anyway, yeah, so Infinity. Super awesome. I'm having a lot of fun with it. I'm going to be streaming it frequently. And if I do any other major upgrades to this machine, I'll probably try to get it on video. But yeah, I think this is pretty much exactly how I want it to be, other than the minor tweaks that I mentioned. Anyway, yeah, hope you enjoyed this, and I hope to see you on Twitch. There's a link in the description to my channel. And yeah, I'll be streaming this frequently. See ya!